Welcome everybody here to your coverage of the RaidCall EMS One Summer Group Stages. That's right, the cups are over and we are down to our last team to see who can be one of the seven teams that will advance themselves forward to go to Poland. We get six teams out from the group stages plus an extra playoff. It will only be a second wildcard chance. It will be basically a single elimination, all games best of one possibility playoff for that last position, seventh position. But let's see who we're going to find. We're going GSL style format group stages, which means we'll get one winner today. And, well, when the other part of the group stage is played out, we'll get that one player on the bottom. It's basically double elimination. Easiest way of describing it. Joining me here in the commentary box for tonight is the man which time does not ravage. That's a very good thing because he wakes up so early in the morning. It's the capitalist. Welcome to the broadcast, man.
Thanks for having me, dear Toby. It's, I don't know, man. I don't know. I think time did ravage me just a little bit last night.
Really?
I can feel it.
You were ravaged? Yeah. Did you really go up against a tide?
Yeah. Bad things happened.
You know you can't fight the tide, man. It's the ocean of life. All right, let me not actually screw with your brain when I know you're just woken up. let's look at our first game tonight. We've got Netolic RU versus FlipSid3. So the Danish boys all together, their full roster is here. There's an extra stand-in tonight for Netolic RU. Which is interesting to note, Hariv.
Yeah, who exactly is he?
Your hint is 3-2-2.
What?
Yeah, I really shouldn't screw with your head, should I?
You said I'm still like booting up here. Come on now, Toby.
Actually, no, my hint is incorrect. It's just Hariv. It's just Hariv. Hadiv, one of the great supporters, he's actually part of another Russian team. And now I'm not quite sure. Damn it to hell. I need to find Hadiv's profile. I've also it's been a rough day, man. It's been a rough day. I'm gonna find player Hadiv, join DOTA. Hell yeah, booyah, kacha. It was. Yes, I'm 100% right. I should not have doubted myself. It's Roskis, Hadiv. Yeah, Mr. Rubik, the Rubik player. So I was right with my hint. I double guessed myself. So obviously in the fallout that is Rock's Kiss. Netolic, you are here. Oh, Netolic, you are here, technically here in spirit. Hariv is playing for them. ESL didn't take any actions against Rock's Kiss. It was just Starladder. Uh-huh. But it seems like the team is splitting up a little bit. Either that or Hadiv is just a normal stand-in here because Roskis aren't competing in the EMS anymore. That could... Yeah.
Yeah, you can... It was like 3-2-2. What the... I can't believe I didn't get that.
Yeah, I know. It's like Mr. Bling, man.
Alright, that's cool. Hopefully with that, Netolic, are you... I mean... So in the past, they've taken on some good, like, Tier 3 teams. Rat in the Dark, Imaginary Gaming, they've come out on top of some of those teams. But they've yet to defeat any real big names yet. And FlipSid3, as much as they have been, they really haven't been living up to their individual player names. You know, you would think, you look at this team and you're like, oh, wow, you've got all the classics here. They have to just be dominating the scene. Unfortunately, they haven't quite yet. But maybe in time, they'll get there. So this should be a pretty good matchup. Netolic, are you trying to break into that, you know, the Tier 2, Tier 1 area? And FlipSid3, who, you know, still kind of suffering as a team, but trying to get there bit by bit.
Yeah, they've got some synergy issues to work out, but these guys, like, time and effort, they will get there. They attended the last EMS finals, so I'm pretty sure they're going to have their mindset to get there right now. And going into this game, as far as Netolic RU as well as FlipSid3 go, this is actually quite an even game. Like, if you're looking for a winner out of this, you're probably not instantly going to be saying, you know what, I'm safe with my rares over on FlipSid3 or on Netolic RU. If I was a gambling man, though, I would actually throw my money over to FlipSid3, just because, like, they are the classic, as you said, they're the consistent players. Like, sure, they may not have, like, the spunk and the aggression that comes from Netolic RU, but they are a really formidable team. You give Unicorn space to farm up, and then this, it's all over. It's all she wrote. But we'll see. We'll see. Let's look at our draft, man. Just start picking out what these players are actually doing. So I mentioned Hardeev and his Rubick. We're going to get that one in this game. Juggernaut and Gyro. So it's all about the stability, the ability to actually solo up the middle lane up against the Quap as well. Work out nicely. Shadow Strike can do very, very minimal damage down at the Juggernaut once you get the Healing Ward up and running. And you've got Gyro. Gyro, the classic Russian. Or classic anybody, really, these days. The Gyrocopter. No, everyone kind of fears him. And then you got from flip side, Nyx Assassin, Queen of Pain, Darkseer. We've got good team fight. We've got good initiation. We've got good jump out, good retreat as well with the Surge. There's many options with just the first three pickups.
Yeah, right now, Netolic, they've got some potentially some really strong mid-game. Lone Druid's already taken out, so they won't really have that overwhelming push. Juggernaut, with that healing ward, well, it's really good for pushes, but it's primarily best when you have a really big unit like that Lone Druid Bear to be able to heal up. They could still benefit from sieging down towers and then using, really abusing that healing ward by, you know, just putting down some harassment on the enemy team, hitting the tower a little bit, backing up and healing. But it looks like they're going to get really aggressive with this. Now that they have a Visage pickup, they've got a really strong lane. Really, really strong. Rubick Visage Juggernaut being able to go in and pretty much have a nice hard disable mixed in with a high damage dealing nuke and some easy, easy kills with that spin. Very, very dangerous to begin with. Flipside, meanwhile, they've got some really good pickups, right? So really good ganking from Nyx Assassin and Queen of Pain. You've got the defensive Shadow Demon pickup, which is going to be extremely helpful versus that Gyrocopter. Shadow Demon is one of those better counters to both Gyrocopter and Juggernaut. So Flipside right now, I feel that they have the stronger draft just because of the fact that even though Netolic does have some good team fight, Flipside will be able to stand up against them with the Queen of Pain ultimate and then the Darkseer wall. And the later this game goes, they're probably going to be picking up a hard carry here, as it looks like. And the later this game goes, I think they should be able to stand up against the push of Netolic RU. They don't have any sort of huge pushing mechanisms besides that healing ward. I think Flipside should be able to stand up against this and then take this late enough for whatever hard carry they pick up to just dominate the game.
I want to go back and correct something I said before, man. Obviously, like, first game of the day is going to be every single mistake. We get it out of the way right now. It's actually Vance Gold was the player I was thinking of from Roxkiss, and it wasn't Hardeev. But Hardeev did actually play for Roxkiss before the finals of the last EMS, EMS 1. So, yeah. He did play for Roxkiss, but he wasn't the person I was referring to. So, still, Hardeev, good to see you here, man.
Screwing with my head even more, Toby.
Man, I'm screwing with my own head right now. That's what's happening. But luckily, you know what? What always just levels me out. I've had a rough afternoon. I've had a very, very rough afternoon. It's bloody hot here. Kind of feel like I'm back in Australia with 32 degrees. And I thought, you know what? Dota. Chill me out with some Dota. We're going to get some Weaver action on this. We've got some Storm Spirit jumping. We're going to get some Soul Assumptions. Some Juggernaut, the master of the jump. We're going to have ourselves some good fun here, man. We're going to have ourselves some good fun.
Yeah, you know, I've never been a fan of a Weaver as a one. I've said that over and over again. But here, it might work just because Netolic RU does not have a whole lot of lockdown. They've got the Rubick Telekinesis, and then you've got Storm Spirit being able to jump in. He's probably going to pick up a very, very early Orchid and try and hunt down that Weaver as much as possible. But that's pretty much your two lockdowns. That's it. That is it for Netolic. So it's going to be really up to the Storm Spirit. He needs to be able to pick up a lot of farm early in this game. Grab that Orchid as fast as possible because, you know, Weaver, you know, he can pick up a Manta. It's not an unheard of item on a Weaver. And once he has that, that's just another disable he never has to worry about. Early Lincoln's is obviously going to be his preferable pickup. Honestly, I don't really see how Netolic is going to be able to stop him. Like, we've seen before, Weavers in these team fights, they just output so much physical damage just over time. And while Netolic does have some really good team fight, Flipside is going to be able to deal with it, survive through that team fight, be able to put out some damage of their own, and honestly, Weaver is just going to be able to thrash every single one of them. So it's honestly, this game is going to be all about Storm Spirit.
Mm-hmm. Well, we'll see if he gets the start he needs, man. As we do have our lanes now coming up, so Unicorn Going to be taking the long lane for this night. He'll be as the Darkseer on the bottom lane. In towards the middle lane, Miguel is the Queen of Pain. That puts Ryze over as the Nyx Assassin. Mania as the Weaver. Puts Miracle then as the SD. And that rounds up our line for Flipside. But all of a sudden, Ryze is coming down to see if he can contest that first rune. But it's a regeneration on bottom, so nobody wants it. Or at least not straight away. But this will be an aggressive trial lane coming off from Netolic. I'm interested to see how successful it's going to be, especially considering Ryze is really missing from that top lane at the very, very start. He's gone walkabout, man. He's gone walkabout.
Yeah, I'm not entirely sure what he is up to here. Unless they're planning on... Okay, they're planning on doing a tri-lane at bottom now, or ganking middle.
They're going a long route
on this one.
Yeah, this is almost basically drawing the two circular circles to the middle lane. One goes around this way, one goes around that way, and then they try and go. Awesome, groovy. First stun, Eli. They're just holding him out of the lane. No matter burn to start with, it's just a stun, and they're rotating their tri lane. They want to leave Mania as a solo so they can run an aggressive tri lane with the Darkseer and add more pressure towards the Storm Spirit, because he's got one for one right now. He's been completely zoned out of the middle lane just by knowing these supports are rotating for him.
I mean, honestly, what can this lane do? They can kick Weaver out a little bit once they pull the lane back and they put down some counter wards, but honestly, it's not going to be enough, and this is actually going to catch Gyrocopter out of guard.
Yeah, you're already seeing Ryze. He's careful. He's careful. He knows what's coming for him, so he just holds back past the creep wave. This way he'll have to contest Unicorn directly. But that's still a very dangerous thing to do. Mania having a little bit of a luck going his way. Pull over to the side. Didn't actually take his entire creep wave, so not as much luck as you might have hoped.
Yeah, all around this is really smart, because Weaver is able to survive in this lane just fine. While Darkseer, he has a little bit hard time going up against Gyrocopter. There's potential there for Gyrocopter to pick him off. At the very least, Gyrocopter can survive really, really well in this lane and pick up a really good CS. Rubick, middle.
Yeah, already got that stun going. There's a pickup on Miguel, throwing him away, but it's still going to be first blood going to actually Miguel, even though Ryze was the one attacking it. Rubick trying to relieve some of that pressure that Flipside were applying. And being a little bit unsuccessful.
Netolic now has to move their lane somehow. And it looks like their answer is going to be moving Rubick to bottom. But I'm not sure if that's really going to be enough. I mean, Darkseer is still going to be able to constantly put pressure on this tower. They can easily dive them. So you're going to probably see some more kills going down at this bottom lane. Because they can't leave Juggernaut alone top versus a Weaver. So Netolic has put in a very, very bad position for the laning phase now. All because of that that switch up that they did.
Yeah. And this switch up, like, it's come half-heartedly. Like, yeah, you're right, like, you pull Rubick down, that's not enough. That's not enough, you need more, and that's why more is on the way. In comes the Visage. And Flipside saw that, obviously, with their creep wave up on top of that tier 1 tower. They forced the rotation out. And that's all they're really searching for, because now Weaver's got all the space in the world to do what he wants to do. And they've already won the middle lane. Queen of Pain 13 for 10 up against a 6 for 4, and this aggression under Storm Spirit makes bottling so difficult. But Eli, he wants to give this a shot. Miguel, he doesn't have mana, he's going to walk himself away, and Eli's actually got bullet charge up his sleeve, he's going to bring down Miguel.
Oh.
Wonderful play, realized Miguel overcommitted himself, running out of mana. So he stood his ground and fought it up.
Yeah, Miguel a little underestimating that bottle a little bit. Once that bottle charge went off from Storm Street, just the slight amount of heal, and it was guaranteed that he was going to be winning that man fight. So, a little bit of a mistake there, but it looks like Ryze is going to try and provide a little pressure. Once Queen of Pain comes back, they're going to go for the dive here.
Well, he realizes Eli's also out of mana, but Eli's also running for an illusion rune. Miguel wants to make sure he stops it. Blink. He can't get close enough to slow him down. You can see him trying to get close enough for the strike, and now he actually is. In the meantime, there was a Darkseer dying in the bottom lane. Miguel, is he really going to commit to this one? Actually, he's got it. He's got it. There's no bottle charges left. He'll tick out from this. Dying back at the tier 3 tower. Nice knowing how far he can go, and then Miracle. Actually going down the bottom lane. Last bit of a soul assumption, able to kill him right in front of those Wild Kings.
Yeah, they can't really afford to lose this tri lane because they did a really smart thing changing up their lanes. You look at Top Juggernaut, he's had to throw down the healing ward. He just can't get anywhere near the wave without taking huge amounts of damage. So as long as they survive in this bottom lane, they're fine. They forced rotations, they forced teleports. They were already winning with just that. They didn't need to get overly aggressive. And now after they've lost two kills, that's going to be a lot of gold going the way of...
He's trying to go here on Eli. They don't really have enough to control him. Body blocking him up. Just trying to force it. Actually, he can't jump. No level 6 just yet, so he's going to go down right now. Wonderful body block by Ryze, enabling Miguel to get that kill. Good plays coming out from all these teams. I guess not even overextension. It's forced errors which are being made.
Yeah, I'm really impressed by FlipSid3's strategy here. The movement is really paying off, except for those two deaths at bottom. The movement is really paying off. Juggernaut's really going to be suffering, and really that's their mid-game carry here. Gyrocopter's obviously going to be their one, trying to build up a lot of damage and use flat cannon effectively, but Juggernaut is really the hero that his mid-game is his bread and butter, and if he can win that, if he can control the mid-game and go in with a significant gold advantage, yeah, he can take this late, and Omni Slash will still be a very, very powerful force, but if you shut him down early, he is really just not much to talk about. Like, you get a good Omni Slash, and it still doesn't matter if you don't have that damage. If the enemy team already has their Ghost Scepters and their levels just to be able to survive through it. Middle.
Having another jump, are they? Yep, this on the Storm Spirit. And again, before he's level 6, Quapaldi gonna fly out. Even though the Nyx will go down, this will be the death, or will it? Solar Sun's gonna do a lot of damage to Miguel. And he realized at the last moment that he couldn't just stand and fight up against the Visage, especially when Visage also went stick charges up his sleeve. So it becomes a 1-1 trade, but Nyx for the Storm, that's a decent trade for FlipSid3.
Supports are going to be focused on roaming around. Nyx Assassin is obviously putting a lot of pressure on Storm Spirit middle. Again, rotations. Storm Spirit, the longer you keep him from being able to get level 6, the longer you can keep him from getting that Orchid, those are going to be hugely important, and they're already giving themselves a lot of space. He's going to...
There's going to be a Grave Chill. There it is. Slows him down. Surge is about to come off cooldown. The Rocket is right behind him, though. And he gets himself up to the higher ground. And Nyx was rotating in just in case Netolic was thinking about overcommitting themselves. Which they do not. Which means everybody is fine. Everything is well.
Mania's going to be able to pick up his Lincolns before Orchid is picked up at this rate. So, I mean, they've just pretty much given the game to Mania. He's going to have to throw to not be a huge force in this game.
Well, either that or Netolic just rotate everybody towards the top lane. Because the power of the healing ward does allow them to push, but they don't have any pushing style heroes. Lone Druid was banned out in the early stages of the draft before. So where is their damage towards the towers coming from? It's meant to be like a full gank lineup, but you can't gank heroes who have escape mechanisms like a blink that's going to disrupt up where the Juggernaut's going to be jumping to, or who he can actually kill off. Or you have things like Time Lapse, the Shikuchi, you've got this invisibility, you've got the SD, you can disrupt up people who are low, you've got Dark, so you can surge him out, and Nyx has also got an invisibility up his sleeve once he gets that level 6, which is taking him some sweet ass time to do. But it's very difficult for Netolic to really execute their draft. Just because of all the, I don't even want to say counterpicks, but escape mechanisms that are up here on FlipSid3.
Yeah. Meanwhile, Gyrocopter doesn't even have that much farm. He didn't get either one of those kills, he just got the assist gold, and his CS is actually not that good. He's only 4xing his lane, probably due to the pressure of that tri lane early on. Really shut him down, so pretty much they're winning all of their lanes. FlipSid3 coming out of the laning phase looking very, very strong, and they're still going to have... a lot of time. I feel that they shouldn't go too late against the Storm Spirit Gyro middle.
There, yep.
Jeez.
Sting stun, or Scream stun, ulti, and Storm Spirit just pops. And that's a Storm Spirit also just at level 8. Oh, Hadiv. Blink Scream. This will be his death. Netolic, they're trying to bring some support in coming in from the Visage, and while he does have a full set of soul assumptions, it's still Miguel who's already picked up a double kill. He has to retreat back out again. And now it's Miguel who's building into the Orchid with a double robe up, Sage's Mask 2. He's just going to go straight Orchid without them even knowing he's doing it.
Yeah. Honestly, they You saw the pinks going out. I was just about to mention, they really need more than just wards. They need that ward over there, either that they need some sort of laning ward, and then some sort of rune ward. Just because of the fact that, like, this Nyx Assassin is constantly ganking middle. I mean, it's the fourth or fifth time that he has run middle and gotten a gank off. They really need to have the vision to be able to see this. Storm Spirit is such a key hero for their lineup. They can't afford to let him die over and over again. He's pretty much the most important hero in the laning phase, I feel.
Got smoke movement on the top. Visage and Rubick together, trying to use the Juggernaut as bait. And they're going to see if they can bring down Mania. Pick him up, throw him down. Sentry Ward to give him the vision. He's still got time lapse and we'll use it. So he just goes down. This is what we're talking about. Where you cannot control a Mania. Juggernaut tried to ulti him too. But he went out of range of the Sentry Ward. And now Hadeev, he will tick out from that. Or actually, no, he won't. Stick charges will keep him alive. But there is still no escape for the Visage. Didn't even require much of a rotation. But having Queen of Pain there and farming up the familiars, all the bonus gold in the world. Coming the way of FlipSid3.
I know there are creeps around, and it would have been tough, but they need to throw down that counter ward immediately and then just go for the Omni Slash. Like, I know that the bounces to the creeps would have been difficult, but without a second disable, that Blade Fury is never going to be able to do enough damage to kill him. He's just going to be able to just run away. Shikuchi out, and you'll never have enough damage to be able to finish him before he ultimates. So, honestly, they should have just thrown out the Omni Slash in the very beginning once that counter ward was down and just hope that it was going to be landing on the Weaver and not bouncing to the creeps.
Yeah. Well, hope is one thing, man. They tried to get for security, and they lost it. So now 4-7 on the board. T1 tower is under siege on the top lane. Just so people know too, I know Netolic are playing under Alias tonight, so with two of their players, and our boys over on joinDOTA in the match ticker have done their research on it, and it is in fact Stalina who is taking up the role as that Visage under the name of N, and it is Sidoy who is playing the role as the Gyrocopter. Everyone else under their right name, so Stork, Elite, as well as Hadeev. That's the full lineup.
Sometimes players like to keep the casters on their toes a little bit, you know?
Yep.
Just choose random names out of a hat. Bottom tower is going to go down. That's what they need. They need some early gold. That way they can pick up the BKB on Gyrocopter and just run it FlipSid3. Like, they have to just run at them and hope that Weaver's not able to get enough farm by the time they try and crack open the base.
Got ourselves a quick pause. So we did just lose Unicorn from the game. Sky problem. I mean, raid call problem. Voice communication software issue is coming out.
Yes.
See, if only they're using raid call, they wouldn't have that kind of problem.
Look at Storm Spirit, by the way. I mean, his gold is atrocious for a solo mid. And it's not that it's his fault. Like, lack of vision, being thrown down for the Nyx Assassin ganks. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's pretty ridiculous how much pressure they put in that middle lane. But he's got boots, bottle, and a magic wand. Another 900 gold. That's it. You know, right now, his gold per minute for mid, like, he's sitting at 244. That's really awful for Netolic. Honestly, they have to group up as five and force some team fights and just hope that FlipSid3 makes some mistakes. Like, they're that far behind in the laning phase. They really needed Storm Spirit to get some very, very fast Orchid. That way he can put pressure on Queen of Pain and put pressure on Weaver and shut them down from being able to just pick off heroes. Like, now there's nothing, without that Orchid being picked up in time, there's nothing that's going to stop Weaver from being able to just dominate. Mm-hmm. Just dominate all of these supports. They're just all going to get picked off. And they don't have the burst damage either.
Jump on bottom lane. They're just searching for Sidoy. And he's forced back behind the tower. This is just frustrating for him. Iron Shell's coming in, the tower's taking damage. They're forced to use... they're actually just bailing. This is how much they feel. I know we're talking a lot of the time, talking about FlipSid3 controlling everything while they kill off the Juggernaut in the top lane. It's because they really are. Like, we're just being realists here. We're not gonna, like, sugarcoat this for you. No fluff approach to Dota commentary. FlipSid3 are just controlling the map everywhere you're going right now. And the only way Netolic can really survive this is to get their strat working. It's their initiation style. They've got to use Storm Spirit to jump in, but he doesn't have a mana pool to actually do that. Visage. He needs his teammates to last long enough so he can build up the soul assumption and actually do something. Then he can get his familiars up maybe again, which he now can resummon after he lost them almost instantly. Hadiv, he needs his level 6, so he's got some of Flipside's abilities to actually turn on them. And then you look to Seedoy on the bottom lane as the gyro, and he's hoping for a BKB, but now with the Surge, it's going to allow Vendetta hit and the follow-up stun, blindly doing it behind the tree line, and Mikkel just ulties him down. Ryze taking a lot of damage from that tower as well as the creep wave. But either way you look at it, they're being muscled around. Miracle, actually, there you go. Gank up with the Storm Spirit, they're executing their strat. Gyro for an SD, not the best one, but at least showing that Netolic could go on the front foot.
Yeah. I mean, they need to group up like this. Soon, Miguel's going to be able to have his Orchid. He's going to be able to pick off heroes left and right. It's going to be hard enough to deal with that silence in the middle of a team fight. But you can manage. You can manage. You can back off. You can survive with the Storm Spirit. Survive through the silence and then come back in and, you know, try and use your mana pool effectively. If they're separated, though, there's just no way. Miguel's going to be able to focus down the Storm Spirit, and he's never going to be able to survive, and that means no Orchid, no follow-up damage whatsoever. Juggernaut also suffering in CS right now. He's sitting at 43-6. Highest gold per minute on Netolic RU is your Gyrocopter, and that's not a surprise, seeing as he's been able to sit bottom and get pretty much free farm, excluding that that tri-lane for that small period of time. But other than that, he's pretty much been able to pick up free farm, but he's still below the three cores of Flipside. Even Darkseer is ahead of him right now because he is about to pick up his mag. Actually, already has it, and a Staff of Wizardry already picked up as well. They're just light years ahead of Netolic. Meanwhile, double damage, I guess, picked up by Queen of Pain.
Sorry.
Toby.
Sorry. It happened again.
Would you blank out?
I kill my mic, man. I kill my mic. Take a day off, and then all of a sudden, all crap goes to hell. Nice initiation on bottom lane. It's so easy for them. With the catcher, with the purge, they just hold Seedoy in position. He does a lot of damage, however. Forces disruption out from Miracle. But Miracle's still having enough damage, and now Elite jumps down, they pick up the SD. That took a lot of commitment for those two supports to try and bring down the gyro. At the same time, Weaver is still free farming top lane, and Queen of Pain's having a great old time in the middle. That should be completely ignored, the fact like it was still a one-for-one trade.
Once again, I mean, Flipside, they start out with the Juggernaut and the Storm Spirit in middle. Now they're constantly moving rotations over to try and shut down the gyro. I'm really impressed so far by their movement. I mean, this is where their experience really goes to play. They know what they have to deal up against. And so they know who they need to shut down as much as possible. Orchid is picked up by Miguel. Now at this point, anybody's food for Queen of Pain. Now that she's picked up level 11 as well, has that level 2 Sonic Wave, there's nobody who can survive through this full combo.
Mm-hmm. Well, we're about to see one of them not survive. If Miguel caught a glimpse of him, nope. Just a little bit faster out. And they got a sentry ward a little bit higher up too. And who's Miguel going to look for? The DD just wore off. He walks underneath the invis and they can see him. They can see him perfectly. Steal one ability and Miracle trying to help Mothgod disrupt him to save his life from Eenlight. And that means a turnaround. Purge to go out in the Storm Spirit and then it's a blink away as quickly as possible for Miguel. But Miracle, he'd be the sacrificial lamb for this one. Whereas cooldown and soul assumption just taking so much of his life. But he did save Miguel.
Yep. Worthy sacrifice, and it looks like they in his Holoc, no surprise, they're going to try and push in.
Stuns up, Quap ulti over two. Stork lucky enough to be spinning at that time. Miguel, he needs to walk away. Storm Spirit will actually not tick over. And Juggernaut jumped in, able to get the hit off the Queen of Pain. Got a lucky couple of hits then. And then, not so lucky to get himself out this one. Mania with a triple kill. He ran through them at the start of that fight, and then just sat up on the Radiant Hill and just attacked Netolic as they were caught in the river.
That was such a ballsy move by Flipside, actually jumping in like that, but it was just beautiful. They knew their allies were kind of be coming in from the side. So really good communication there, and just all around a really ballsy play that played off well for them. Even though they lost the Queen of Pain, they pretty much wiped Netolic. Netolic grouped up, and they did what they had to do, but it's still showing that Flipside is not going to let them just five-man. They're going to play, they're not going to allow Netolic to play a numbers advantage.
Back. Purge, stun, Shikuchi, Damage to kill him off as she came from the Iron Shell. Storm Spirit's going to jump out. They've already popped up the mech to try and counter off the effect. That was the cooldown, and Unicorn, he's going to surge himself away to safety, which should be successful at, but Miracle, not a good position for him. Juggernaut Aldi is down, so he just starts spinning Miracle. He's actually got some good wand charges up his sleeve. I don't know if it'll be enough, though. Into the corner, now the Orca, the Sting, buying some space. Scream as well, Miracle being surged away. They actually keep him alive while bringing down two heroes, and Stork caught in the corner. Wonderful Familiar Sun, actually keeping Ryze away. He was inside the Vendetta, and Miracle came back in to help him. Anything he could do, throw a poison level out. And FlipSid3 don't lose anybody in that one. Ryze kind of wants to kill off anybody. He's just sitting here looking to go. But Vendetta's going to wear off. He's going to go back and heal.
No.
Oh, Ryze. Don't get caught under familiars, man.
So Netolic's playing it smart. For right now, what they're doing is they're trying to put Gyrocopter on the Weaver. Whatever Weaver pops out in Division, just throw down that Rocket Barrage and man fight him. And just hope that it can deal enough damage that Weaver isn't allowed to just be able to move around and pop off some of those supports. So that's a smart play there, but unfortunately they still lost a couple of their supports and they can't really deal with the mobility of the Weaver to shut him down completely and get a kill. But they can at least survive a little bit longer if they just put some Rocket Barrage on him, put some aggression on the Weaver, make it feel that he isn't safe to be able to just run through and auto-attack down all of the squishies. But meanwhile, wow, Dagon is picked up by Unicorn. And this honestly is not the biggest troll item. Just because you look at Netolic's team, they all have very, very squishy heroes. We've talked about how Gyrocopter is very susceptible to nukes. Even when he picks up his BKB, just being able to, if you can nuke him down, or at least get him low beforehand, bottom though.
Yep, trying to surge in Ryze again, and Vendetta hit. Actually moving around nicely is Cedoy, but he's not ready for the Dagon to come up from Unicorn. The mech charge has to pop off, but nice follow-up stun. Stealing that impel, Hadiv. Locking these two very aggressive FlipSid3 players down. And, well, you asked for Game of Throws, man. We're getting closer with maneuvers like that. You're throwing two of your lives away after you got all these kills, and then again, you still got Mania on the top lane. Try and dive after Stork. Not really going to be successful. In fact, already time-lapsed himself back to the other side of the tower.
Yeah, that was pretty unnecessary dive going on there. Really good turnaround there by the Gyrocopter, running back to his allies, making sure that even if he did die, that they're going to pick up two kills. So, throwing down the cooldown as well was a really smart play.
I like this this warning from FlipSid3. As always, we're going to watch bottom lane die. Disruption, catcher to walk to the other side first, but there's TP support coming in. Purge just to keep Cedoy away, but Elite jumped himself in, and then Miracle be pulled back out. And that's his death. Yeah, but the warning I want to talk about is actually behind that T1 tower in the bottom. This warning position, it gives you vision, of course, around everywhere at the back as far as, like, anyone moving into the jungle. Anyone moving into Natalic's jungle is not about. But most of the time, you look for the hill. You throw an Observer and a Sentry Ward up there because that's where you look for the most amount of vision. But in this scenario, it's just far enough away. The Sentry Ward range has also been nerfed, so it won't be close enough to reach it. I like the warding. Just want to say that.
Yeah, it is really interesting, and it's smart to just throw it up on the hill. Just because, you know, everybody throws it up there and everybody counters it.
Middle
though.
Yeah, Visage, Dagon, and Poor Swipe. Okay.
Oh, man.
I misclick? Had to be misclick.
Yeah.
No, it can't be a misclick, because you got to click and then click. There's no way that was a misclick. That was an intentional wall bomb.
I guess he was afraid that his auto-attack damage wouldn't be enough, and he wanted the nuking damage of the wall. Either way, I mean, it's a very long cooldown, but they don't need to push in anytime soon. I mean, honestly, they can probably just wait till they get a pickoff and either take a tier 2 or go for Roshan. They just need to stop going for the dives here. Like that, again, they went for the bottom tier 2 dive again, and there was no plan. There was no plan there. Like, what if somebody teleports? Well, then I guess you're screwed. Like, that's pretty much the reaction of diving that far in. Like, they have a Storm Spirit. You can't just be getting too aggressive.
Like, middle lane, Miguel is going to go down. He needs to blink himself away, but the stuns just continue. Ryan's trying to give him a little bit of extra space, but Hadiv still having that stun of the Nyx Assassin. Now, Urn Charge. It's a double kill coming the way here of Cedoy. And Unicorn and Miracle have to hold on top of the T1 tower. And now 5-man Dota is going to be great for Netolic. Is that actually full BKB? It is. It's full BKB now coming in the way of Seedoy. Hadeev, he's already got level 10. Earn charges, Dust, Arcane Boots. We got Bracer up on Visage. He can survive a little bit longer. Sure, Storm's not getting much up on that top lane. It's the Juggernaut, but still, Drums, Phase Boots, one for 23 minutes in after his start. It's not bad. Now, Unicorn back in. He doesn't have his wall. He threw it out before. Dagon's quickly onto the Visage. And they keep on trying to find these kills. Mania actually hunts out Fluffy, the Devourer of Weeds, but he's going to go down for it. Diving to actually get kills on Couriers while you've got everybody else, including the Gyro, on such low life. He thought he could time-lapse out the damage, but very much incorrect.
Again, just completely unnecessary. Weaver, while he is tanky, he can't get picked off, right? He can't get... there's no way Storm Spirit or Rubrik or any of those heroes are going to be able to jump in on him and be able to secure a kill. That shouldn't ever happen. But him diving through the middle of five heroes, though, well, yeah, there's obviously going to be enough burst sometime to be able to kill you. Just all they need is one lockdown, and they're going to be able to secure it. So he has to wait for Queen of Pain, that big initiating force who can run in and, you know, throw down some nuking damage and put Netolic on the defensive before he tries to go all man mode on him.
Mm-hmm. The beautiful thing is, though, Netolic know how to play against this kind of, like, diving crazy style. They're Russians! Yep. Like, it's what they live, it's what they breathe. They came out of their mother's womb, best basically, diving into it. That's what happened. And now it's 14-19, and Flipside are losing control. I can't believe I'm saying that when they were 12,000 gold in front, and over 12,000 experience in front. It's only a small shift. But a small shift is all you need for a Gyro to get you back into this game. For a Juggernaut to get his remaining 2,000 gold and get an Aghanim set to jump at level 16. He's going to do a lot of damage until he possibly dies to Miguel. Is Miguel going to throw ulti for this one too? Orchid's going to wear off. Storm Spirits in the neighborhood. Now they're too far in. Miguel blinks away and he blinks actually down into Gyro. Disruption trying to save him, Stalk. There goes his ult, but he realizes that Unicorn is wearing him out. With that Meg charge back in, there goes your wall. But it's still going to be a double kill. Coming the way of the Visage and Quap. Nice ulti. Can't scream and go again, though. And maybe Mania. There's not enough damage. He's being held. He's being controlled. He needs to time-lapse out this damage sometime shortly. And now Gyro, Quap in the tree line. Miguel, he's actually living through this. I'm not quite sure how. Hadeev is trying to bring him down, pick him up with telekinesis, but couldn't control him long enough. And that's why Miguel, the Urn Chargers, trying to counter him off Hadeev. Now he was the one diving too far. Familiar Sun will hold Rise there. Miguel lives to fight another day, and Light trying to run away with the bugs right in his tail. Mania even getting a heal as he goes. And Storm Spirit, all the mana he's got, jumps himself back to the tower to help kill off that little bug. And two heroes from Netolic able to escape.
Yeah. That was a nice attempt by Rubrik, but... honestly, it made that team fight not worth it. They had a 2-for-2 trade there. Yes, if Rubrik had been able to pick off the Queen of Pain by using Shikuchi to get in range for those final auto attacks, that would have been awesome. But unfortunately, he just gave away another kill. And, I mean, Storm Spirit, he benefits from that one because he's going to be able to pick up his BKB fairly soon. The fact that he didn't die, he was able to pick up some kills, some assist gold, that sort of thing. Juggernaut's working towards his Aghanims, and... that's going to be really important. If they can get the 2,000 gold and pick up level 16, he's going to be doing a lot of damage in these team fights, even if they are grouped up. He's going to have enough bounces to be able to constantly keep going, no matter the number of units. So, I mean, honestly, like, flip side, they just need to finish off the rest of their items. They can't get too cocky against this lineup. They're still facing up against the Gyrocopter. He's going to be very...
At the same time, Seedoy can't get confident either. He's sitting down here on top of his own tier 2 tower. At this stage of the game, a tier 2 tower will not protect you. Of course, the tier 1 tower is taken in return. Netolic doing a 4-man push up the middle. Gyro was the one who was missing him. Now TPs are coming in. Leaves the Static Remnant behind. Pick him up. Throw him down. Goes into the spin. And now Ryze going to die here in the middle of all of this. One stun's his last gift. Unicorn going to come in, a vac into a wall. Where's the vac? He only got one. The vac didn't bring it back far enough. There goes the Visage at the back end. Gem of True Sight not being picked up. In fact, it's been left there on the ground. But the rest of Netolic are retreating out. And now it has been picked up. Weaver will take it. And I'm wondering right now if they just say, you know what, let's just go for Roshan and then just try and end this game. Push it and end this game.
Yeah. They, okay, there it is. Scythe of Ice is picked up now. Now they have an extra disable. It's something that really they only had Nyx Assassin for some really hard disables. So they needed another really hard, big hard disable like that. So now they have both the Silence and the Sheep up on Miguel. Mania's going to be able to put a lot of damage here once he picks up his MKB. I say once they finish that, they should just go all in. They've got, you know, Dagon 3 being picked up on Darkseer. Because of that, they shouldn't really let this game go late. He doesn't have, you know, the Aghanims, and even if he did, it isn't that good against these heroes.
Stalk.
Juggernaut.
Initiated, and then just destroyed. Or is he? No Heart Eve. Buys him some space. Queen of Pain with that ulti and the sting. The Orchid damage plus the sting. It's not going to be enough to kill him off.
Beautiful.
TP already out by the Rubick, and whoa, 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 whoa. Rise! He's going to live with one charge. They back him back in again. The cooldown's there. Storm Spirit will jump on Miguel. And now Unicorn. He's already used the mech. Rise wants to lend another stun. And only hits on the creep wave. None of the heroes. And the Rockets chasing down Rise. He'll blink himself away. But Netolic, fantastic count initiation. They lose the Juggernaut, but they pick up the Quap and the Darkseer.
Yeah, excellent play. Excellent play. Even though they lost a tier 2, they have to. They know they're trading something every single time they go for these kills. So, really well done. They're going to take a lot of damage to their tier 3, but at the very least, they're going to be able to pick up a little bit more gold for themselves. Try and get themselves farther into the late game.
Mania.
Gyrocopter.
Mania. Needs a time lapse. He needs a time lapse right now. Doesn't actually take. Oh, wow. He has a lot of damage. And then Disruption. Only thing that's saving him right now from the gyro, and he's not going to get it, or is he? Urn Charge will tick him out. He needs something else. Aegis Immortal. Aegis Immortal. Aegis of the Immortal. It's a Morgul. It's a Morgul blade.
Yes. Okay, so once again, Flipside getting way too aggressive. They took a tier 2, did a little damage to the tier 3, that's fine. But now they lost their Aegis right as they're about to pick up their big item. MKB was grabbed. I was going to say, once they have that MKB, just force the fight. Just force the fight and use that Aegis advantage. With a 5-man group up, you can take a tier 3 pretty easily without Netolic really being able to do too much to stop you. I mean, they have some good, decent turtling with Flat Cannon call down, and then, of course, Storm Spirit being able to jump in and out. Just the fear of being able to pick off one of those squishy support heroes, and if he doesn't get it, well, he can just back up and go to the fountain real quick. But now they've kind of thrown that advantage. They need a pick off like middle.
Okay, that's not nice, man. That's not nice.
Dagon is not a nice item.
Especially when it's up in levels. That's a level 4 Dagon. And they're gonna run. Well, who are they actually searching for? Mania's the one on the bottom lane. There goes the dust, but they triggered the Lincoln Sphere as well. Shikuchi away, and they're running out for this one. They should not be out this far because Unicorn comes in. Juggernaut, nice jumping time. Unicorn, he's still going to get this mech charge up, which he will do so. Purge trying to slow. Well, who's he even slowed down? The Purge on cooldown, he can't use it. It was just a catcher, and now Mania got to help out his teammate. Miracle, one crit, second crit. And he just goes down. Even the Solar Touch can be thrown for that one. Rubick also able to steal the wall during that fight. Hence, we have the double. It's a one-for-one trade, technically. And Miguel, who's just farming up top lane and taking out tier 2s. Who also has Scythe of Ice and 3,000 gold. Like, he's got so much money right now. Weaver's about to crack the 200 mark. But he wants to crack the bottom tower first, though. Which now he realizes he's overextending himself just a little bit too much. So we'll retreat back out again. And something's coming in on the Courier. It's the Ghost Scepter for Rise. So now he's got a jump in ability, which lets him stand next to the Gyro.
Flipside, or excuse me, Netolic, they're staying together as a unit, and that's their advantage. With the healing ward and telekinesis obviously being a really good hard disable when teams are grouped up like this, they're sticking together as much as possible, and it's keeping the Weaver from being able to pick off any heroes, because every single time he pops out, there's the danger of a lot of damage being thrown his way. All they have to do is, like, Gyrocopter, he just has to keep his missile just to be able to pop that Lincoln's. And at that point in time, Weaver has to be very, very scared. He only has 1,600 health. That's enough to burst through. Just a simple disable plus an Omni Slash. And they could wipe him out. And at that point, it's just pretty much, once they kill the Weaver, it's pretty much open season for the rest of Flipside.
Mm-hmm.
all they have for damage at that point is going to be Miguel, who's probably going to be already have bursted everything down.
I'm also waiting for him to go for something a little bit more physical DPS. Like go the Draskill build with Mjolnir. I call it the Draskill build because it was tried and tested during the Staff Cup. But you could also look at the Monkey King bars. There's so many different items he could be going for, which could be that physical DPS to get through heroes at the Juggernaut when they're spinning around, when he can't nuke him down. And he needs an option for that more than just jump in and get the Scythe of Ice before they start spinning and get their immunity up and running.
Yeah. BKB would also be a nice little choice for Queen of Pain, but he still has to deal with a lot of physical damage coming out from both the Gyrocopter and the Juggernaut, so he may just forgo that item, even though it would be a strong item versus the disables of Storm Spirit and Rubick. He may just forgo that item for some damage like you're talking about. He needs to start transitioning into more of a semi-carry build who...
Who is your favorite hero in competitive drafting and why? Capitalist? Answer
Capitalist first. In competitive drafting? Well, shit. If there's a difference between drafting and favorite hero in general, so...
Yep. So, in a competitive draft, who's your favorite hero?
There's also a difference between favorite and good. Honestly, wow. Yeah. Honestly, I really prefer, like, heroes like Darkseer. Utility-based heroes that start out, whether they be offlane or mids, utility is, I feel, the biggest, strongest pickup early on in the draft. So, I'm going to say Darkseer. Why not?
I'm going to say Keeper of the Light. And the reason why I say Keeper of the Light is because Keeper of the Light allows for any lanes. So during the draft, so I'm not talking about during the game, I'm talking about during the draft. During the draft, you see a Keeper of the Light come out, and you can't instantly say these will be the lanes just because Keeper of the Light's in there. That's why I like
So we're kind of on the same wavelength here, just because of the fact that utility-based heroes, you can't really... Granted, like Darkseer, you're like, okay, he's probably offlane. But at the same time, you even though you can acknowledge that, you can't necessarily shut down... you can't make a draft according to that Darkseer offlane, because then he just... He's either going to be just like a lifestealer. You can draft against him, and you can try and counter him as much as possible. Doesn't mean you're going to be able to actually shut him down. You know, the theoretical, yeah, we can throw it on Bane Ultimate or those sort of things, versus what the actual execution is very, very different. So even though you can draft against heroes like Darkseer, you know, they can just, you know, go into the jungle, pick up things. They're always going to be extremely powerful. They're playmakers. Being able to, you know, hit a good vacuum can completely shape the team fight from there on out. A lot of utility heroes are initiating based. Your Windrunners, Darkseers, any of those sort of heroes have really powerful disables or surviving mechanisms to be able to help out the team.
We think alike, man. We think alike. It's simple for commentators. We like things that are different and enablers.
Favorite drafting hero? It's just a weird question.
It is. It's a question, though.
Yes, or your favorite hero? Good, but
it's a really good question. It's a really good question because it's a question which I've actually never been asked before. What is your favorite hero to see in the draft? I don't know if he actually intended it to be that legendary of, like, enablers for drafts or, like, great heroes. It's, like, what affects the draft. Or if he's just like, oh, I actually just meant what was your best hero in the game. But, yeah, the wording of it made, yeah, interesting. Anyway, game back up again. 20-26. A reminder for what else is coming up tonight, guys. We are only doing game number one of this best of three between Netolic and Flipside. We'll be jumping ourselves to Imaginary Gaming versus Quantic Gaming. That game will be coming up at the conclusion of this first game. So the boys from both Quantic as well as Imaginary Gaming will be remaining. It's difficult to miss an all-French matchup. It really is. Obviously with Ukrainian and other elements involved. Miguel jumps down, so then he can go. Oh, Juggernaut. Ulti. They're going to try and stay together. Unicorn just took so much of that attack. They try to stay together so Miguel can actually share the burden of it. But it was too much in a board time for E-Line to actually rotate himself up to that top lane, get the jump on him, and now two big cores of Flipside go down.
That's, I mean, Dark's just one of the cores you never want to sacrifice to one of your cores, but that was one of those moments they needed to. That Omni Slash does so much damage.
Oh, Miracle. Are you really trying to do this by yourself? Destruction? Mania's coming in as well? I'm really not sure about this. Blink, stun, Ryze jumping in deep. They're going to get the kill out here on the gyro. And then force the time lapse itself back out. But Storm Spirit will chase this one. The Weaver Bugs hit nicely across all of Netolic. But then BKBs are up and running. Ryze, he's trying to get himself further away, but he will go down. Keeping that vision up and then just getting three heroes on the sidelines for Flipside. For the price of a gyro. Man, Netolic, they're finding the plays, and Flipside are playing Game of Throws, Game of Throws, Game of Throws.
Yeah, that was unnecessary risk, though. Even though it paid off, they were able to trade Nick's Assassin for the Gyrocopter, and that's great. It was an unnecessary risk, because if Rubik, now that he has a Blink Dagger, he's able to, with the right communication, they should easily be able to combo their disables. If nobody else has anything, any small spell to be able to throw down, then Storm Spirit and Rubik should both be focusing their disables on that Weaver. And once they have him, they could pretty much pretty easily output the damage to be able to knock him down within that amount of time. So that was an unnecessary risk there by Flipside. They're just forcing it that Rubik was not in range of that. But it looks like they're going to smoke up, try and pick off Unicorn.
Yep, and they get him perfectly. Nice jump in from E-Light. Hadiv right behind him with that Blink Dagger. Pick him up, throw him down, and even steal 4 points in Iron Shell. This is really now Natolic's game. They are the ones. We always talked about that lineup being that aggressive one. The one that if you could find the openings, you just roll with it. Jara's going to get back easily enough. Man, he doesn't have enough damage to bring him down. He's still got 4.4k gold, which he can spend, but he's not this, oh, I can burst damage you, fear me, fear me, fear me. It's not that kind of thing. Like, even Miguel's not that. He bought BKB, Scythe of Vice, and a Monkey King buff. We don't see the damage coming out from him. We see him going, oh, we keep diving, I'm going to need stability. That's all I'm really seeing. If I see that same thing from Mania 2, I'm going to be really disappointed. If he goes like a Reaver up next and builds into the heart, I'm going to be very, very concerned for him. He needs to have something to eat through. He needs to have his damage dealing with a little bit of evasion. So Butterfly would be the best option for him.
I don't think he can go Butterfly.
Because Monkey King Bar is also coming up from Gyro. So
yeah.
What's the other options? We look at Desolator, we look at Daedalus. If we're looking at damage, we're not going to look at Rapier.
Manta wouldn't be a bad decision. It's some decent damage, gives you some really good stats that will increase the survivability of Weaver, and also allows you, even though it's up against Fly Cannon, it's more units to be able to sack.
Ryze. He's going to go for the Visage instead, but he doesn't have the extra support. In the meantime, Gyro did get nuked down. I thought they're actually going to focus on the Gyro. But Ryze overshot his mark, so, yeah, I assume the wrong target. Gyro does go down. Familiars get sniped off, and with the Gyro on the sidelines, maybe now Flipside feel they got enough to push in, but they need to have Unicorn with them, and he's not. We've got a four-man push on the bottom. It's very unusual.
They need to force a buyback. They can back out if the buyback goes down. But that's all they need. A Gyrocopter has it, but he's still holding on to it. He's hoping that they'll back off here and not take the tier 3.
Well, that way he can finish up his Monkey King bar. Nope, there's the buyback. And they find an opening. The Hex, the Orchid up on the Juggernaut. They can't finish him off, though, in time. And Stormspear has already jumped down, looking at Unicorn. Mech Charge to pop off, and Unicorn being disrupted up, going to save him some time. That's a really great Familiar Stun, following up with a cooldown. Miracle back into the wall. And now there's copies of the Gyro trying to throw that Dagon out. Unicorn. It's not enough. Back in again. Ryze, nice three-man stun. Might be able to save him. Ghost is up and running, but he just gets fade-bolted down, just picked up and thrown back again. Flipside, they're trying to throw themselves at this Netolic lineup, and it is not working.
Yeah. And that team fight could have gone much, much worse. Flo actually never blew his BKB there. He actually stopped using, he stopped auto-attacking to wait for the Nyx Assassin Spike Carapace to go down, which is a really smart play, except for the fact he did have BKB, so he could have just BKB'd, ran forward, and I think they could have gotten maybe one or two extra kills off of that. But instead, they're going to smoke up. They know that if they can pick something off right now, they can go for Roshan, and then they can actually take complete control of this game. I still feel that Flipside, as much as they're throwing and as much as they're, you know, diving in and not getting anything out of this, I still think that they're in control of this game. They're keeping the gold lead. They're controlling the map very, very well. And despite the fact that Netolic is picking up kills, that's their main source of gold right now. They're not allowed to pretty much go out and farm whatsoever. But a good smoke gank combined with the Aegis advantage, Netolic would take control of the map.
Jump, top lane, Miguel picked up, thrown down, and Centaur trying to actually just win it for Netolic. Queen of Pain's being locked. Flipside's Roshan attempt is going to cost them not only their Queen of Pain, but also their top tower. This is really getting iffy now.
Yeah, they... because of the fact they don't have any map control, they don't have any vision whatsoever, they were afraid of Flipside actually trying to force a fight there. And so they all teleported out, and now they're not going to get anything off of that. They needed to stay grouped up and just either go to the Roche or push down to Tier 2. Instead, they're not going to get either one. They will get themselves a little bit of farming time, but not very much. Just 40 seconds, and Queen of Pain's going to be coming back. And with that Aegis, I don't think they can go for another kill like that. Weaver... you lock him down once, and that's going to be hard enough. Twice is pretty much impossible, and so that means he's going to have a very long team fight, especially with the heart that he just picked up. Uh-huh. So he's going complete survivability. The reason I said Manta was just more bounces for the Omni Slash to be able to soak up, as well as some really good pushing potential. Mm-hmm. It would get wiped out by the Flat Cannon, but now he can definitely go. And now that he has heart, he doesn't have to worry about those images getting wiped out so quickly. So I still think that would be a really good pickup for him. He'd be able to add in some additional push as well, which they kind of need at this point.
Yeah.
Like, how many times have they been into the enemy base and they just still have not taken that tier 3?
It's been a while, man. It's been a lot of times. Mania has attacked it multiples. And I think he wants to go again. He never wants to give it up. That tower is hitting pretty low. And once that tower goes down, he can move a lot more freely on that bottom lane to get himself in and out of the time, and that's what's keeping Netolic from pushing out the remaining tier 2 towers at Flipside. Mania's big, Ryze runs his bodyguard support, and now they're actually, yeah, it's all five. All five coming bottom lane. They realize probably that Gyro is caught out of position. He's got a TP back right now, or he's going to lose somebody. The stun comes through, actually hit on no one. They tried Stalk, but he went to the spin fast enough. And got himself back out to safety. Familiar is about to be sniped off. You can see Mania and Miguel waiting for it, but they've got to focus. There goes one, there goes the secondary. Not enough to get the kill. And the Radiant's Courier, damn Fluffy, keeps going down all the time. And now they come in. Mania, tower, focus. Linkosphere's already going to trigger on him. He's looking for the Aegis to pop off. There goes the disruption after Eli already initiated down. The wall is up. Mania realizes Rocket keeps following him, but they kill it off. And what has Honey stolen? He stole 3 points wall of replica. Fantastic ability to now have. And he gets a copy of Mania. They pick him up. They throw him down. Juggernaut going to pop his ulti, in fact. He pops his ulti so they can pick up the Aegis Immortal. This can most easily be that bottom racks. Mania runs up, and there's your Hex, Stalk, Orchid. They bring him down, and now with a Juggernaut on the sidelines, they steal back the gem, and it will be in the hands of Mania. Elite able to get himself away, but even inside the BKB, it's really, really rough to do so. Disruption again, saving time for Mania. He's got to get himself away. Nice old assumption, but better Shikuchi. And, well, Flipside, they've still got the cross wall that's happened. The Storm jumps out to him. He's going to get Orchid up instantly and just Dagon down. Suicidal jump! Stalk trying to spin himself into this one. Ryze away. He's got to earn charge himself up, but he's getting it back in again. Three on the back from the Darkseer. Familiar's come up. It's a double stun. It's buying time for Mania to get the attack in through the rear. Searching over now for the Gyro. He gets Spike Carapace stunned up, so only a Rocket Barrage instead of having the full Flat Cannon. Three on the sidelines. Somehow Flipside are keeping their players alive, and Mania, he's on the front lines. Stalk to go down, now with a triple kill, and he'll come in maybe to pick up the Gyrocopter as well. There are not many buybacks. In fact, there are no buybacks really available for the Radiant side. And this will be a bottom racks and possibly even a mid racks, an ultra kill up on Mania. Now up to 5.5k gold.
That was really well done by FlipSid3, keeping each other alive. The fact that even the Shadow Demons survived throughout that team fight, they did a really good job with their Ghost Scepters, all their abilities. It's just unfortunate. Netolic, they couldn't go outside of their base with Flat Cannon. The nerf to Flat Cannon, putting it on 30-second cooldown, it just means that once you pop it, you are very, very vulnerable, and you can't really be forcing fights with that Flat Cannon down. It's just too much team fight damage to go without.
All right, so that's gonna end our game right now, peoples. We'll be jumping ourselves over to the Quantic versus and Quantic versus Imaginary Gaming. That'll be coming up next. Waiting for Gyro to actually leave the game admin to officially end it, or even Mania and Miguel to attack on the Tier 4 towers. But it seems that's not going to happen. We're in a quick on a quick deadline, people. So unfortunately, no time for the end stat screen. We will be returning in just a moment, though. So stay tuned. There's more action coming up to you for the Raid Call EMS 1 Summer Group Stage. First group stage.